Hello students, welcome back. Today I am Anuradha from Arden Progressive School, going to start another topic of the same chapter, that is respiration in plant. So students, in the previous class we have done about the steps of respiration. We know that in case of respiration, when we are talking about the plants, there is a cellular respiration. So in cellular respiration we are having the glycolysis and the Krebs cycle. Okay, so already we have discussed about the glycolysis, because in the respiration process there will be the oxidation of food. So in case of plant, what is the food? The stored food material is the starch, or in form of glucose, right here. So what we are studying, that we have to study that how the glucose can be broken down, and when it will broken down into the simpler one, and it is going to release the energy. So the function of respiration is what? To exchange the gases, right, as well as to release the energy. And how will get the, how plants will get the energy? They will get the energy when the stored food material will get break down, right here. So in this one, we know that respiration can be of two types. What are they? Aerobic respiration and anaerobic respiration. So what is aerobic respiration? We have done this thing, that whatever the oxidation of glucose will take place in presence of oxygen, it is known as the aerobic respiration. So what about the anaerobic? Anaerobic means that when there is a lack, or when there is an absence of oxygen, right? But both the cases, whether it is an aerobic respiration or anaerobic respiration, what is common? The oxidation of glucose. But that oxidation of glucose is partial oxidation. So the first step of the oxidation, which is the glycolysis, will be common for what? For the aerobic respiration, right? In case of anaerobic respiration, again glycolysis will be there. So what will be the product of glycolysis? When the glucose will break down, when the glucose will break down, what it is giving there in the glycolysis? Pyruvic acid, or you can say pyruvate also, right? You can say, pronounce both. So here what happens? The glucose changes into the pyruvic acid or the pyruvate in glycolysis, both in aerobic condition as well as in anaerobic condition. The thing is that in anaerobic condition, that oxidation gives very less energy. But here we have to study aerobic respiration, because in case of plants, during the night hours they are taking the oxygen. So when they are taking the oxygen, there will be complete oxidation of glucose. How? The pyruvic acid, which has been formed in the glycolysis step, it will undergo in another cycle. Okay, it will go in another cycle, so that the glucose should be broken down in a very complete form, because up to here it is a incomplete oxidation, right? But when it will complete, when it will enter into the Krebs cycle. Okay, so here today we will start with the aerobic respiration again, and the second part of aerobic respiration which we are going to start here, the TCA cycle or the Krebs cycle. But before that there is one linking chain. Okay, so when it will enter into the Krebs cycle, there is a linking chain or linking step between the glycolysis, because up to here it is glycolysis, afterwards there is a Krebs cycle, but between that there is a we can say joining step. This joining step is nothing, it is oxidative decarboxylation. Now what do you understand by oxidative decarboxylation? Means that decarboxylation means addition of CO2, decarboxylation means removal of CO2. So here in this step, in this joining step, there will be removal of CO2. So here what is happening? There will be removal of CO2. So you can see this thing here, that it is a pyruvate. This pyruvate, it is coming from where? From the glycolysis. And this pyruvate is 3-carbon compound, and we know that when glucose will break down, it will give 2 molecules of pyruvic acid, right? Because we have done this thing, that we are getting 2 molecules of pyruvic acid, and this pyruvic acid was the 3-carbon compound. So this 3-carbon compound will come here, okay? And afterwards, what will happen? With the help of this coenzyme A, pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme we are using here. Why? Because it is acting on the pyruvate and they are dehydrogenizing, And due to this, when there is a dehydrogenase enzyme, this NAD will transform into the NADH2. So what we are getting here, we are getting energy in form of NADH2. So, and again, there will be release of CO2. We know that here decarboxylation is there. So what it is doing? It is removing the CO2. When it will remove the CO2 during the night hours, we know that during the night hours, what happens? The plant usually takes oxygen and releasing the CO2. So the CO2 will be released by this step, and this steps come under the respiration. So here, what you can say, this is a linking step, which is known as the oxidative decarboxylation, and it takes place in the mitochondria, because whatever the things glycolyzes, because it is a cell, if it is a cell, so how inside the cell cytoplasm is present, nucleus is present, and different cell organelles are also present, right? So here the glycolysis takes place where in the cytoplasm, and as it will complete, it will enter into the mitochondria. So what is mitochondria? It is one of the cell organelle of a plant cell, right? So when it will get breakdown, partial breakdown, so it will enter where? Into the mitochondria. So in this mitochondria, if I will enlarge the structure, you can see mitochondria structure is just like this: inner membrane, outer membrane, as well as this part is matrix, right? So here, as it will complete the pyruvic acid, it will try to enter in the mitochondria. In this mitochondria, what will happen? The pyruvate will transformed into the acetyl coenzyme A, and this acetyl coenzyme A is forming why? Because we have used the coenzyme A here as well as the pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme. Due to this, it will release NADH2, and these NADH2 again, it is a source of energy. Why? Because ultimately we know that ATP is a source of energy, right? But some cases we are getting energy in form NADH2, and this NADH2 has to go in the electron transport system so that it can give ATP. And we know that one NADH2, what it is giving? It is giving 3 ATP molecules, right? Like this, we are getting the FADH2 also. So this FADH2 gives generally 2 ATP molecules, right? So you can imagine that how much ATP we are getting from this NADH2. How many? Because we are getting the NADH2, but how many pyruvic acid we are taking here? 2 pyruvic acid. So from 1 pyruvic acid we are getting 1 NADH2. So from 2 pyruvic acid, how many ATP we will get here? 2 NADH2. So from this linking chain we are getting 2 NADH2, and this 2 NADH2, 1 NADH2 gives 3 ATP. So 2 NADH2 will give 6 ATP. So when it will enter into the electron transport chain, it will give the 6 ATP. Okay, we will understand this cycle also, that electron transport system. But here I just want to explain that from where this NADH2 will go for swapping its energy. Okay, it's just like an ATM. We don't have any currency, but we are sending or we are swapping the card, then we'll get the money, right? Now we got the acetyl coenzyme A, and this acetyl coenzyme A is what? It is a 2-carbon compound. Okay, now this 2-carbon compound will combine with oxaloacetic acid. Okay, so the first step which is happening in this Krebs cycle, now it will enter into the Krebs cycle. So the whole part is what? It is Krebs cycle. Okay, this is a linking chain, and this exactly it is a Krebs cycle. So in this Krebs cycle, what will happen? The condensation will take place. What is condensation? When we are adding something. So what we are adding here? We are taking the two carbon compound which we are getting from this step. It will combine with oxaloacetic acid. We have done that oxaloacetic acid is a 4-carbon compound. So you can see that this oxaloacetic acid, it is a 4-carbon compound, and this acetyl coenzyme is a 2-carbon compound. So when 4-carbon compound will combine with 2-carbon compound with the help of condensation, what it will get? It will get 6-carbon compound. Right here, like this. So the first acceptor of this acetyl coenzyme is what? It is the oxaloacetic acid. Okay, so with the help of the oxaloacetic acid and the acetyl coenzyme A, we are getting the citric acid. What we are getting? Citric acid. This is the 6-carbon compound by the condensation of both
the molecules right here.
So now this citric acid, we have to understand it how this cycle is going on. So this citric acid is a 6-carbon compound again. So it will form its another product, that is the isocitric acid. Okay, so isocitric acid will again, it is a 6-carbon compound right here. So in this cycle, what you are observing that they are forming their simpler forms. Now this citric acid cycle, which is having the isocitric acid and it is a 6-carbon compound, it will reduce its 1-carbon. Okay, so what is happening here? Decarboxylation. Decarboxylation means that removal of CO2. So when it will remove one CO2, so from where? From this 6-carbon compound. So how many molecules will be there? 5-carbon, right? So in the next step, we will get the alpha ketoglutaric acid, which is a 5-carbon compound, and the enzyme which has been used here, it is the isocitrate, because it is acting on the isocitrate and dehydrogen is why? Because we are reducing this NAD to NADH2. Okay, so to reduce this NAD to NADH2, we are using the isocitrate dehydrogenase enzyme. Just to memorize it, you can relate that where we are using this NADH2 and where we are using, where we are forming the NADH2. You can see that we have taken alpha ketoglutaric acid. Before the alpha ketoglutaric acid, there will be dehydrogenation, and after the ketoglutaric acid, there will be dehydrogenation, right? So in both cases, you can memorize that we are getting the NADH2. Again, this NADH2 are the source of energy, the source of ATP, okay? But when they will go into the electron transport system, right now they are not giving any energy, okay? But if directly we are getting ATP, just like the glycolysis, in the glycolysis we are directly getting the ATP. So that type of ATP, what we have done? Substrate level phosphorylation, right here. So but here what is happening, they will go into the electron transport system, then only they will give the ATP, right? So after that, it will form the alpha ketoglutaric acid. It is a 5-carbon compound. Again, this 5-carbon compound will come into the succinyl coenzyme A, which is a 4-carbon compound, by removal of one more CO2. And here again, there is a dehydrogenase enzyme which will transform the NAD into the NADH2. Okay. So here, as it will form the succinyl coenzyme A, it's unstable. So to make it stable, it will form the succinic acid, and this succinic acid can be pronounced as a succinic acid or the succinate if we are talking about the ion. So this succinic acid or succinate is a 4-carbon compound. So you can see here from where we have started, from the 4-carbon compound, with the help of 2-carbon compound we have made the 6-carbon compound, then again 6-carbon compound, then 5-carbon compound. Here again we are getting the 4-carbon compound. Why? Because we have to maintain this 4-carbon, because this is the only thing which will accept this 2-carbon compound, then only it will form the 6-carbon compound, right here. So what is happening here? This succinic acid is a 4-carbon compound. Now if this succinic acid will transform into the fumaric acid, okay, fumaric acid or the fumarate, and this fumarate is also a 4-carbon compound, right here. So what you are seeing here, that when we are forming the fumarate, what type of dehydrogenase we are using? FAD to FADH2. You can relate this thing in your mind, that F for fumarate and F for FAD, FADH2. So up to here we are getting the NADH2 from NAD, but here we are getting the FADH2 from FAD. And we know that one FADH2 gives 2 ATP. Okay, they are having more capacity to give 3 ATP, but this FADH2 will give only 2 ATP, right here. Now this fumarate will transform into the malate or the malic acid. This malic acid again is a 4-carbon compound, and the enzyme which has been used here, that is the fumarase. Why? Because it is acting upon the fumarate. Okay, so when it will act on the fumarase, it will form the malate, and this malate again regenerate this oxaloacetic acid. To regenerate this oxaloacetic acid, we require again energy, and this energy in form of what? NAD to NADH2. So again from here also we are getting NADH2, and the enzyme which will act upon here, the malate dehydrogenase. Why? Because it is acting upon the malate, and this NAD will transform into the NADH2 with the help of dehydrogenase enzyme. So this cycle will keeps on working, okay, because it has to maintain this thing. Now you can imagine that if I will talk about this whole Krebs cycle, only about the Krebs cycle, not about this intermediary step. In this intermediary step, we are having two molecules. How many molecules of pyruvic acid? Two molecules of pyruvic acid. Now, in this, we are getting again two molecules. So, how many ATP we are getting? Two molecules of NAD also. That's why we have calculated six ATP molecules. Now, when it will enter here, again it is having two molecules, right? So, how many molecules? One NADH2. So, I can ask that how many NADH2 we are getting from this Krebs cycle. So, how can you calculate? The one NADH2 from here, NADH2 from here, and NADH2 from here. It means that in this Krebs cycle, we are getting 3 NADH2. But the molecules are what? The molecules are 2 molecules. So, how can you relate? This one can be multiplied because it can be 2 molecules, 2 NAD, and 2 NAD from here, 4. Then 2 from here, 5, 6, and 2 molecules we are getting from here, 8 ATP. So, if I will combine this joining step and the Krebs cycle, total how many NADH2 we are getting in this one? We are getting 8 NADH2. Okay, and 8 NADH2 means 8, 1 NADH2, 3. So, 8 means they will multiply with 3. Right here. So, we will understand whole the balance sheet at the last when we will complete the electron transport system. So here what we have to understand that in one cycle what we are getting? We are getting the different types of NADH2 and how many FAD? We are getting 2 FADH2. Why? Because we are having 2 molecules. Okay. So in one cycle we are getting 1 FADH2, and if it would be 2 molecules from starting, it would be the 2 FADH2. Right? Like this. GTP just like a ATP. Okay, it is also known as a substrate level phosphorylation because directly it can give the energy. Okay, so we can equivalent with the ATP molecule. So here what will happen? This GTP will give again the energy, but here 1 GTP, 1 ATP. Right? Now you can see here that in the photosynthesis, what we are having? C6H12O6. And we have to break down this glucose molecule. So how we will break down this molecule? Because in the cycle you can see that how many carbon we are having? Only the one carbon. Okay, so but we have to utilize six carbon. So this cycle should be followed six times. Okay, so in one time all these things will happen. So this cycle must be continued for the six times. Then only we can break down two molecules of pyruvic acid. Okay, or we can say one molecule of glucose. So for one molecule of glucose to break down, how many cycles should be there? There must be six cycles of this Krebs cycle. Then only there will be a complete oxidation of glucose. Okay, so up to here Krebs cycle is completed. Now we will understand that how the energy can be transformed in the electron transport system. So now here we will understand that what is electron transport system. So electron transport system is what? In which there will be movement, or there will be the movement of electron here. So how it will move? We can see here it is a metabolic pathway, okay, which is happening due to the glycolysis as well as the Krebs cycle, and through which electron will pass from one carrier to another carrier. So electron transport system will take place with the help of electron carrier. So we are having different electron carrier in this electron transport system. So to understand it, we should know that how many enzymes or how many complex they are acting upon. Okay, so you can imagine that, as we have said, glycolysis takes place. After glycolysis there will be the membrane of mitochondria. This is the inner membrane of the mitochondria, and this part which I have shaded here, it is the intermembrane because it is present between two membranes. So it will be the intermembrane, and the thing which is present inside this lumen, this is known as the matrix, which I have shown with the green part. So this part is what? This is the matrix or the lumen of the mitochondria. Okay, so now how this electron transport system will take place? This takes place in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So what is the inner mitochondrial membrane? This part is the which I am making it thick, it is a inner mitochondrial membrane, and in this membrane what will happen, the electron will move. Okay, the electron will move. As it will move the electron, what it will do, it will send the energy towards the outer side. Okay, it will send the energy towards the outer side. So how you can imagine this structure with this structure? See here, I have shown this part is matrix. So it means that this is the middle part where exactly the electron transport system is going to happen. Okay, so this part which I have shown here, this is what, this is the inner mitochondrial membrane, and this part is matrix. From here, matrix is what, this green part. Okay, this green part which is present inside it, it is known as the matrix. And what is the intermembrane? Intermembrane is this shaded part which I have shown here. Okay, so exactly where it is happening, in this infoldings. Okay, now understand that how this will take place. We know that from the glycolysis and from the Krebs cycle, we are getting NADH2, we are getting FADH2. Okay, ATP can be utilized directly, but NADH2 and FADH2 cannot utilize directly. So it will undergo the electron transport system. So this NADH2 and FADH2 will come here, where, in this matrix. Okay, when it will comes into the matrix, it will send this NADH2 and FADH2 towards these inner mitochondrial membrane. Okay, so now this NADH2, okay, this NADH2 will break down into the NAD, and when it will break down, what it will give? It will give proton. NAD will give what? It will give proton NADH plus H positive. Okay, in this form it will give proton, as well as it will also give electron. Okay, so proton will just move outside and electron will move into this electron transport system. So how it will move? For that, there must be a different complexes or different enzymes. So here we totally we are having 5 complexes. What are they? First complex, we will not use the complex in a sequence form. You can see here, first I have written first, then I have written third, then second, then fourth, then fifth. Okay, everything is in the sequence. Just in this third complex, before the third, we cannot say second will come, first third complex will come, then second complex will come here, right? So you can see here, I have drawn different complexes or different structure. I'm just making it thick here also. So this one is first, and this one is third, and this one is second complex, and this one is the fourth complex. Okay, and this one is the fifth complex, or this one is the fifth enzyme. Right, now what exactly it is happening here, you can see that the first one is NADH dehydrogenase. You have to memorize all the names of these complexes. The first complex is what? NADH dehydrogenase. And the second complex is succinate dehydrogenase, and the third complex is cytochrome BC1 complex, and the fourth one is cytochrome C oxidase, and the fifth one is the ATP synthesis. Okay, now the name itself indicates the first complex, which is the NADH dehydrogenase. What it will do? It will dehydrogenase with the help of this dehydrogenase enzyme, and this NADH2 will transform into the NAD, and it will give proton as well as electron. So this proton will directly move towards the intermembrane. So you can imagine here, if proton is releasing here, where it will go? It will go towards the intermembrane. So this part is what? Intermembrane. So from here, when there will be NAD formation of proton, it will give electron also. The proton will just move towards the intermembrane, and electron will move into this electron carrier. So the first electron carrier which will accept the electron, it is known as the FMN. So FMN is what? The first electron acceptor which is present in the NADH dehydrogenase enzyme. Okay, so this electron has been accepted by the FMN, and it will give to the FES. Okay, then FES will transform into the UQ. UQ is what? Ubiquinone. Okay, this ubiquinone, again I will add one hydrogen, and it will give UQH2. Okay, so now this UQH2 will enter into the third complex. You have to understand this. that UQH2 will transform into the UQ transformed into UQH2 and it will enter into the third complex. When it will enter into the third complex, who will accept this one? Cytochrome B. Why? Because this complex is known as the cytochrome BC1 complex. Okay, so this cytochrome will accept this UQH2, and during the same time this will remove its hydrogen and it will send towards the outer or the intermembrane side, and it will give 2H positive here. Okay, like this. Again, we are talking about the second complex. In second complex also, we are reducing the FAD will transform into the FADH2. Okay, when it will transform into the FADH2, what it is doing? It is forming the proton. This FADH2, FADH plus H positive. Okay, so what will happen? This H positive will move towards again into the intermembrane, and what will be remaining here? The electron. So electron will move into the complexes here. The first electron acceptor in this part, it is FAD. So FAD will give electron, which will be accepted by the FES, and FES again it will transform into the UQ and the UQH2. Then from this UQH2, again proton will move towards the intermembrane. So total how many proton we will get here? 4 protons. 2H2 from this side and 2H2 from this side. So total how many proton we are getting into this intermembrane? 4 proton. Okay, so here what is happening, that in this third complex the electron will come from the first complex as well as from the third complex, right? Now from this UQH2 it will enter here, and this cytochrome will change into the FES, and this FES into the cytochrome C1, and all they are taking the electron from the cytochrome C, because it's a lighter molecule, it will enter into the fourth complex. Okay, the fourth complex is cytochrome C oxidase. So the cytochrome C will get oxidized here, but what is required here? This copper molecule, this copper is needed to take the cytochrome C into the fourth complex, and it will transform into the cytochrome A. Okay, and this cytochrome will change into the cytochrome A3, and with the help of this copper again it will accept this cytochrome right here. Now up to the cytochrome C oxidase, what is happening? The water molecule will be formed here, because we know that during the respiration what happens, there will be release of what? There will be release of oxygen, but during the CO2, during the CO2 what is happening? That CO2 is coming outside as well as the water. So this water is coming from half O2 and the proton which is coming from this intermembrane. So we will understand that how the proton is accumulating this side as well as this side. It's just like the chemiosmotic theory which we have done in the photosynthesis. Okay, so here what happens, it will send again proton. So you can imagine that how many protons will be accumulated in this intermembrane. So whatever the proton they are getting from this electron transport system, it will release in this intermembrane. So now the concentration of proton will be more in this intermembrane. So what it will do? It will send back into the lumen. Okay, so how it will send back? With the help of this ATP synthase enzyme. This ATP synthase enzyme is useful for sending this proton towards this inner side, okay, or we can say into the matrix side. So here this F0 and F1 particle is a part of ATP synthesis enzymes. Just like the chemiosmotic theory, we have done ATP synthesis enzyme is there, F0 particle is embedded and F1 particle is protruding. Okay, so when it will enter here, it will send back, or it will send all the proton this side. Okay, so now the concentration will be maintained in the intermembrane as well as the lumen. So this proton will come here this side, and this proton when they will combine with this half O2, they will form the water molecule. So it means that these are keeps on working. Okay, along with this what we are getting? We are getting energy. Why? Because these NADH2, FADH2 will come in this electron transport system, and they will give the energy in form of ATP. So here what we are getting? We are getting the ATP molecules, and this ATP molecules are useful for any of the metabolic activities in the plant cell, as well as we can relate this thing into the animal cells or the human cells, right? Now at last, whatever we have done in this chapter, the respiratory balance sheet. So in the whole process of respiration, how many ATP has been used and how many ATP we are getting. So at last, how many ATP? we have done the first step, glycolysis. Glycolysis is what? Partial oxidation of glucose. In the partial oxidation of glucose, how many ATP molecules we are getting there? The 2 ATP molecules in the payoff phase. In the payoff phase, how many direct ATP we are getting? 2 ATP molecules. So directly 2 ATP molecules. Okay. Now, how many NADH molecules we got from the glycolysis? We are getting the 2 molecules. Okay. And as we know that 1 NADH2 will give 3 ATP. So 2 will give 6 ATP. So total how many molecules we are getting here? 6 ATP molecules. Now comes to the another one. That one is the intermediate or the joining step between the glycolysis and the TCA cycle. One more thing about the TCA cycle is that it is given by the Hans Krebs in 1940. Okay, that's why the cycle is also known as the Krebs cycle and also known as the citric acid cycle, because there is a formation of citric acid and this citric acid is the first stable compound which will form in the Krebs cycle. Right here. So this joining step, pyruvate to acetyl coenzyme A, how many molecules we got of NADH? 2 molecules. How? Because we are having 2 molecules of pyruvic acid. So in one step we are getting 1 NADH2, but when we are having 2 pyruvic acid, it will form 2 NADH, 2 molecules of NADH, and 1 NADH will give 3. So 2 molecules of NADH will give 6 ATP. Okay. Now comes to the third one, citric acid. So up to here there is no complete oxidation of glucose. So complete oxidation of glucose will take place when there is a citric acid cycle. In the citric acid cycle, how many molecules we are getting? 6 molecules. Why? Because one cycle is there. Okay, so in one cycle we said that 1, 2, 3 molecules we are getting. So how many molecules we will get? 6 molecules of NADH, and 1 NADH gives 3 ATP. 6 NADPH will give 3 ATP. So total we are getting 18 ATP. Okay, now comes to the FADH2. So how many FADH2 we are getting? 2 molecules. Why? Because in one cycle we are having what? We are having 1 FADH2. So 2 molecules of FADH2 will be there, and one cycle will give 1 FADH2 will give 2 ATP molecules. So 2 FADH2 will give 4 ATP molecules, right? Then comes to the GTP. GTP we are getting directly, okay, just like the ATP, we are not converting into any part. So directly we are getting, we are having 2 pyruvic acid, so we will get 2 GTP molecules, and this 2 GTP will give 2 ATP molecules. So total, if you will go for the total of these ATP which we are getting from the complete oxidation of glucose, so we are getting 38 ATP molecules due to the aerobic respiration. But in the anaerobic respiration we are getting only 2 ATP. Okay, that's why this aerobic respiration is responsible for giving high energy, right? So ultimately we have done about the whole respiration process here, how it will take place. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you.